Good morning, everyone. Thank you for that lovely introduction. And what a rousing start to the morning. I'm really privileged to be the first speaker. Privileged to be with you and with my colleagues from Stanford. I want to talk to you about the body as text. And I want to tell you that our ability to look at the body and diagnose diseases and tell all the myriad things that are going on is very recent. Until the mid-1800s or so, no matter what ailed you, pain, cough, fever, you would go see a barber surgeon, and the barber surgeon would cup you, bleed you, purge you, and if you wanted, also pull a tooth and cut your hair long at the sides and short at the back, but would make no attempt at diagnosis. My medical students are always surprised to learn that our first ability to read the body as a text, a superpower, if you will, began because of a man called Ornberger, who I'll mention in a second. I just want to point out to you, you probably already know this, that the famous barber pole with the red and white stripes represents this legacy of the barber surgeon. The red and white stripes represent the bloody bandages. The brass receptacle at the bottom represents where the blood was collected. It was this man in the late 1800s who got us started in our ability to read the body as text. His name was Leopold Ornberger in Vienna, and his father was an innkeeper. And one of his early memories was going down to the basement of the inn with his father and watching his father tap on the sides of the kegs of wine to determine where the meniscus was and whether it was time to reorder or not. And when Ornberger became a physician, he began to tap on bodies. He began to what we call percuss and effectively map out the size of the heart, the presence of fluid in the lung, the size of the liver, and so on. Everything we know about percussion, which was the ultrasound of its day, was discovered by Ornberger. It was really a huge moment in medicine, followed very shortly by this gentleman, Laennec, here in Paris, who discovered the stethoscope. Till then, as you can imagine, if you wanted to listen to the patient's chest, you had to apply your ear to the chest wall or the abdomen, which, as you can imagine, from time to time presented some aesthetic difficulties, and Laennec came up with the stethoscope. And all of a sudden, by the early 1900s, we had this phenomenal ability to read the body as text, not just because of the stethoscope and percussion, but also the ophthalmoscope, the blood pressure cuff, and we began to have magnificent clinicians who could really read the body. And just to show you an example, I'm going to tell you a little anecdote that involves this person. This is actually Arthur Conan Doyle. He's the author of the Sherlock Holmes series, as you know very well. What you might not know is that Conan Doyle's inspiration for the character of Sherlock Holmes was his professor at Edinburgh, a man by the name of Joseph Bell. Now, Bell was an extraordinary clinician, but probably not that different from many extraordinary clinicians who existed on both sides of the Atlantic, especially in France, which was the epitome of this kind of clinical skill. But Conan Doyle, writing in The Lancet some years later, described what it was like to be a student of Joseph Bell. You can imagine Bell seated in the outpatient department, students all around him, and a woman comes walking in with a child, and she says, "Good morning, Dr. Bell." And Dr. Bell says, "Good morning, and what sort of a crossing did you have on the ferry from Burnt Island?" She's shocked. She said, "It's a good crossing." "And what did you do with the other child?" She said, "Well, I dropped my other child off with my sister in Leith." And he says, "And did you take a shortcut down Inverleith Row to come here today to the infirmary?" And she said, "Yes, I did." And he says, "And would you still be working at the linoleum factory?" And she said, "Yes, I am." Mind you, this is before she's taken off clothes or been examined. Can you imagine how much more a Bell would deduce? And he goes on to explain to the students, "You see, when she said good morning, I picked up her Fife accent, and the nearest crossing from Fife is Burnt Island. Secondly, you observe that the coat she's carrying is too small for the child who's with her, and therefore she started this journey with two children, dropped one along the way. Third, you notice that the clay on the soles of her feet is a kind of clay that's not found within 100 miles of Edinburgh, except in the botanical gardens, and Inverleith Row is her closest shortcut through the botanical gardens. And finally, you notice the dermatitis on the fingers of her right hand, which is characteristic of the linoleum factory workers of Fife." I don't know about you, But my medical students love that story. I love that story. It's the kind of superpower I came to medical school to acquire. I have to share with you a different story. This is an individual, not this particular individual, but this is an exemplar of a kind of patient who shows up in North American hospitals fairly regularly, usually complaining, in this case, of left hand pain. And tragically, many months will often go by while the primary care physician x-rays the hand, finds nothing, sends the patient to an orthopedist who examines the hand and the shoulder, finds nothing, and it may take some months for people to diagnose what Joseph Bell and any number of physicians 100 years ago would have diagnosed in an instant, that this patient has Horner syndrome. He has a little lag of the left pupil, and he has a smaller pupil on that side, and they might have picked up that he was a little hoarse, and they would have said instantly, without even looking at the hand, that he has a tumor at the apex of the lung. To find out why, you'll have to come to the breakout session. It's not important. It's important to know, though, that for some reason, this fairly common, well-described condition is something we miss now with regularity, where someone like Joseph Bell would never have missed it. I would consider it a major error for us to delay diagnosis because we failed to pick up something that people 100 years ago picked up fairly regularly. And the reason might be captured by this diagram, which I really like. It was drawn by a patient who had gone to see her pediatrician. And she drew a little sketch of her, to her, a wonderful visit. And she depicts herself, as you see, sitting on the exam table. Her mother and sister are sitting beside her, and the sister is playing with a doll. And the doctor is pictured as having his back turned to the patient. Now, I have to tell you about this physician, because he was traumatized by this picture. This was an individual who loved pediatrics. This is an individual who spent 1 year on a U.S. carrier in the Mediterranean, taking care of 250 Navy corpsmen and every emergency that could happen to them. And he then came back, and because he loved children, engaged in a pediatric residency, had three children of his own during the residency. And when he saw this diagram, he was crushed. In the stimulus package that the government put together, one of the major expenditures was to create electronic medical records. And one phrase that he said caught my attention. He says, "We spent however many million dollars on the electronic medical record. I wonder what this will really cost us in terms of the face-to-face interaction, in terms of patient care." So we have this paradox where we have the wonderful ability to see things in the body that I could never have imagined when I was in training. It's a wonderful time to be a physician. The kinds of imaging that I can access daily, remotely, is quite incredible. But it has come with our declining abilities to pick up the very simple things that Joseph Bell, Laennec, Olmberger would have picked up 100 or more years ago. And we at Stanford think that this is not right, and we have taken the lead on doing something about this. We think that although we can't have rounds totally be like this around the bedside, this is rounds from Boston City Hospital where I trained some time ago, rounds have increasingly become like this, where the most important person in the room is missing, namely the patient. Instead, it becomes a discussion of data. It becomes a discussion of what I call the iPatient, you know, like your iPhone, your iPad. We have an iPatient who gets wonderful care all across America. The real patient often suffers just a little bit. Now, I think that we can't afford to lose these wonderful clinical skills for two reasons. One is we have to be able to pluck the low-hanging fruit. If you come to visit me in my office, you will notice these strange plastic fruit dangling from under my desk and on my bookshelf. It's because I want to make this our metaphor, that we will not let any of our trainees walk out and never have it on our conscience that they missed the low-hanging fruit and someone who has a diagnosable, treatable condition is picked up 3 months later when they're no longer treatable. That should not be on our conscience. That's one good reason, I think, to examine the patient well, to listen well, to get not too caught up in technology where you stop seeing the patient. But the other reason is perhaps even more interesting. My wonderful interactions with colleagues in anthropology, including Dr. Kapoor, have taught me that the ritual of examining a patient is an important one. It's a ritual. Think about it. Someone comes to you who you don't know. They tell you things that they wouldn't tell their rabbi or their preacher. or their priest. And then incredibly, they disrobe and they allow touch, which in any other context could be assault. That is an exceedingly important ritual. Patients have certain expectations of it, and if you don't fulfill that ritual, they walk away feeling, my doctor didn't pay attention to me, something was missing. Rituals are all about transformation. We engage in rituals to signify a crossing of a threshold, be it marriage or death or a transition of power. The ritual of examining a patient also has a transformation. What is it? Well, it validates the personhood of the patient, and it locates the illness on their body, not remotely on some screen. It takes their symptom, and you put your hand on where it hurts, and you validate that. You affirm your connection, commitment, and trust. And finally, we have this very interesting phenomenon that's really wrapping me up in terms of the data that's coming out on the phenomenon of placebo without placebo. We've learned for some time that placebo is not about tricking people with a sugar pill, that you can actually produce profound neurobiological effects with a placebo. You give a Parkinson's patient a placebo, not only do two-thirds of them stop shaking, but you can also measure in the ones who stop shaking a surge in dopamine levels in their brain. You give a patient who's in pain a placebo, and one to two-thirds of them, the pain will vanish. If you use a morphine antagonist, the pain will come rushing back. Placebo produces real neurobiological effects. And we're learning that you can have placebo without placebo, meaning context, tone of voice, the ritual of examination, all these things are profoundly important in the biology of disease. I can only begin to highlight this in the 8 minutes I have. I want to close with a little anecdote. I'm an infectious disease specialist, and in the early years of my practice, I took care of many young men predominantly who were my age, who were dying of AIDS. And I remember my sense of futility going back there by their bedsides as they were dying towards the last stages. And I remember in particular one young man who was dying, and day after day I would go by to visit him. I'd see his family there, and I would never know quite what to do. And out of a loss for knowing what else to do, I would do my ritual. I would begin to examine them. I would percuss the lung, I would listen to the heart, I would feel the belly. Not that there was any information I was going to gather at this point that would change very much, but it was my ritual. And I remember this one particular young man on the very last day of his life, hours before he died. As I came to his bed, his mother told me that he had not responded at all for the last 12 hours. And as I was just standing there talking to her, we saw his hands come fluttering up. And we were wondering, what is he going to do? And they went to his pajamas and he began to fiddle, and I realized he was going to expose his chest to me. He was wanting me to examine him. That this ritual, which was in a sense meaningless to medicine at that moment, was incredibly meaningful to him. It meant, for one thing, I will never abandon you. I will see you through this. I will be with you through the very end. I'm very proud to tell you that we at Stanford consider our technology paramount, but we consider the sanctity of the physician-patient relationship, the superpower of being a great clinician, to be equally important. Thank you very much.